Come on, let's encourage one another in the Lord today. Let words of life come out of your mouth this morning. Amen. Amen. The Lord bless you. You can be seated. Let everything, good morning, let everything that has breath praise the Lord. Amen. If you want to know whether or not you're to praise Him, just kind of just blow in your hand. If you got breath in your body today, then you should be given that breath to praise the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Amen. It's so good to see all of you this morning, and I just want to say along with Pastor Darren, goodness, it's good to see you today. All of our guests today, Cooper City, can we welcome all of our guests this morning? It's an honor to have you. And again, our online audience that's joining us today, it's always a pleasure to be able to connect with people who aren't able to be here on campus, but they watch from wherever they are in their homes, their cars, their places of work. We're just thrilled that the gospel of Jesus is going out of these four walls, amen? And we thank God for the transforming power of His word. I want you to take your Bibles this morning and go with me to Numbers chapter 6. And we'll get to that passage here in just a few moments. If you don't have your Bible, you can go on your iPhone, you can go on your iPad. If you have the Cooper City Church of God app, you can go to the app and you can get all the sermon notes for today. You can follow along with us. But while you're getting prepared, and I hope you got your notepad today too, so that you can take some good notes, so that you can carry this word with you and make it a part of your personal devotion time. But while you're getting all of that organized, I just want to remind you guys, men, September the 9th is our next Sharper Saturday, and I'm hoping that many of you guys will join us from 8 to 12 on that day. It's a free event. I know when we first advertised it, there was a fee on there, but it is a free event. Can I say that again? It's free. Ladies, look at your husband and say, it's free. See, so you can't use that as an excuse for not being here. And we're going to have a wonderful breakfast for you that morning. And I believe that every one of us is going to leave sharper than we came. And then September the 10th, Bishop Dwight Allen is going to be here. Bishop Dwight and Bonnie Allen. And I still refer to him as the father of this house, the pastor of this house for more than 30 years. And there's a lot of you that wouldn't be in this house today if it wasn't for Pastor Dwight and Bonnie Allen, who loved you enough to share the gospel of Jesus with you and to love on you once you came into this family. So we're excited about that. And then I think the ladies have a little event coming up here in a few weeks. Fearless Women's Conference just around the corner. And if you've not registered for that, you need to. There are tables back here where you can sign up today for Fearless, where you can sign up for Sharper Men. And we just hope that as many of you that can will come and be a part of these great events. Well, over the last 21, or actually we're kind of in the middle of our 21 days, or two-thirds of the way through, our 21 days of prayer and fasting. And during this 21 days of prayer and fasting, I've been talking to you about some powerful prayers that we find in the Word of God. We started off talking about the prayer of Jabez, which was a prayer of blessing. He said, Lord, bless me indeed, enlarge my territory. May your hand continue with me and keep me from evil so that I'll not bring pain. And then the Bible says the Lord granted him his request. You see, prayers don't have to be long to be powerful. They can be powerful as long as they're prayed from a pure heart. And then last week, we went to Acts chapter 4, and we looked at the prayer of the early church, which was a prayer for boldness in the face of opposition. For boldness, and not only for boldness, but they also prayed that God would continue to do healings and miracles and signs and wonders. So not only did they pray bold prayers, they prayed big prayers. And I challenged you last week that this week in your prayer time, pray some big things. Don't be afraid to ask God for big things, because God is a big, big God. And as I said also last week, I think God is just sitting up there in heaven saying, hey, give me something hard. Give me something big so that when it happens, there's absolutely no doubt who it was that did it and who it was that made it happen. Amen. Today, I want to talk to you about the prayer of the priest. Now, when I say priest, I'm not talking about a Catholic priest. I'm talking about the priests from the Old Testament. This was a prayer. Really, it was a declaration. It was a blessing that the priest was to speak over the people of God. Now, before I share that blessing with you, and before I share the passage of Scripture with you, let me just give you a little bit of context about where we're going this morning in Numbers chapter 6, beginning around verse 22 down to about verse 27. A little bit of context, as you know, the nation of Israel's come out of Egyptian bondage. They've crossed through the Red Sea. They're now in the wilderness at what is called Mount Sinai, and they've been at Mount Sinai for a year. And during that time, of course, Moses has been up on the mountain getting the law from God. But after being there for a year, it's now time for them to depart from Mount Sinai and begin their journey through the wilderness toward the Promised Land. And so before they leave for this journey, God speaks to Moses, and he said, Moses, I've got something that I need you to tell your brother Aaron. Now, not only was Aaron Moses' brother, but Aaron was also the high priest at that time over all of Israel. And he said, it's very important before you leave this place and take another step that you tell Aaron to do what I'm about to give you instructions that Aaron is to do. And here's what he told Aaron. The Lord said to Moses, tell Aaron and his sons, this is how you are to bless. Everybody say bless. He said, this is how you are to bless the Israelites. He said, say to them. Now, how many of you know if you want to bless somebody, you do that many times with your words? That we speak blessings over people. We speak blessings over our children. Proverbs chapter 18 tells us that death and life are in the power of the tongue. And so we're either speaking death over our children or we're speaking life over them. And I really believe that this is not just a prayer that was prayed by the priest in the Old Testament, but those of us this morning who call ourselves Christians, we are in Christ. And in Christ, you are a chosen generation. You're a royal priesthood. So we are all priests in the kingdom of God. Mom and dad, you're the priests of your home. And I believe that this is a blessing that you're to declare over your children every single day of their life before they leave that house. And at the end of this service today, we're going to be praying over our kids, over our young men and women as they get ready to go back to school. And we're going to be singing about this blessing. We're going to sing this prayer over our kids before they leave today. And he said, this is what you are to say to them. The Lord bless you and keep you. Some of you already know the song. But you know, if we're not careful, sometimes we can know the passage and we can sing the song, but not really understand what the passage is really saying. Well, when we leave here today, we're going to have clear understanding of what this blessing is all about. But he said, the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face toward you and give you peace. Now, before I go on, let me just share a few what I think are interesting things. This may not interest you at all, but it was very interesting to me. Because what I see in this blessing is I see that as the blessing progresses, it enlarges, it expands, it compounds. And you have to look at it this way, that in the original Hebrew text, the first sentence, the Lord bless and keep you, the first sentence is three words in the Hebrew text. The second sentence is five words in the Hebrew text. And the last sentence is seven words. So you see that as it progresses, there's a crescendo. that it enlarges, it expands. It gets even more interesting. In line one in the Hebrew text, there are 13 syllables. In the second line, there are 15 syllables. And in the third line, there are 17 syllables. Again, you see as it progresses, it crescendos. Gets even more interesting than that. When you look at the consonants in each one of those sentences, there are 15 consonants in line one, 20 consonants in line two, and 25 consonants in line three. Some of you right now are probably thinking, Pastor, don't you have any better use for your time than to study those kinds of things? No, it's interesting to me because that just tells us that only God could do something like this. Matter of fact, when you take the name Lord, the three times the Lord is mentioned here, if you take that out of the Hebrew text, do you know how many words are left? 12, which is one word for all of the 12 tribes that represents the different 12 tribes of Israel. Only God can put a blessing like that together. And so he said, the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face toward you and give you peace. And then he said, so they will put my name on the Israelites and I will bless them. That when you speak this blessing over my people, when you put my name on them, I'm going to bless them. But not only that, people will be able to know that my name is on them because of my blessings that are up on them. So what I want us to do this morning, let's take this line by line so that we can get real clarity about how to pray this prayer and declare this blessing over our children, especially as they're getting ready for another school year. First of all, the blessing begins by saying, the Lord bless you. Everybody say bless. I just like that word, bless. You remember we did a series back at the beginning of the year on the Beatitudes. And we talked about blessed are those who are poor in spirit. Blessed are the meek. Blessed, blessed, blessed. Well, that word blessed there means happy. And the word blessed here in the Old Testament, it means to bend down. So this is a picture of God bending down and giving to his children gifts, giving to his children blessings, blessings that the end result of is happiness in your life. Now listen, somebody one time said, God doesn't want you happy. I don't think that's God's primary priority for our life. I think his primary priority of our life is he wants us holy. But God does want us happy. But he wants us to know that happiness can only be found in him. Now see, we can talk about all the blessings that come as a result of God being in our life. But what we need to remember is God is the blessing. Amen? God is the blessing, and everything else that comes as a benefit of that is just that. But notice it begins by saying, the Lord bless you. Look here in Numbers chapter 6, verses 24 through 26. You got to see this. It says, the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face toward you and give you peace. And then verse 27 says, so they will put my name on the Israelites and I will bless them. So five times there, we see that it is the Lord who blesses, which tells us that God is the source of all blessing. Amen. How many of you know that God is a blesser? And how many of you know that God wants to bless you? Many of you are blessed here today because of God and for no other reason than that, but because of God. I think it's also interesting that after God first created the first man and woman, Adam and Eve, do you know what the first thing he did with Adam and Eve was? Bible tells us in Genesis 1:28, God blessed them. God blessed them and said to them, be fruitful and increase in number. God wants you to be fruitful. God wants you to increase. He said, fill the earth and subdue it. Rule over the fish in the sea and the birds in the sky and over every living creature that moves on the ground. So the first thing that God did with humanity, God blessed them. But can I tell you the last thing that Jesus did before he left this earth? It tells us in Luke 24:50-51. It says that when Jesus had led his disciples out to the vicinity of Bethany, he lifted up his hands and blessed them. And look at this last sentence. While he was blessing them, he left and was taken up into heaven. So the last thing that Jesus does before he leaves this earth, and as he's leaving this earth, is he's blessing his disciples. So the first thing God did was blessed. The last thing Jesus did before leaving is he blessed. Amen. And may I say to every one of you that's in this room here today who is a follower of Jesus Christ, whether you know it or not, you are blessed. Not will be blessed. Now listen to me, not will be blessed, yes. Some of the blessings of God you have yet to experience, but let me just tell you, you have been blessed. You have been blessed because the Apostle Paul tells us that God's blessing is both corporate and God's blessing is personal. Look at verses 22 and 23. Notice, the Lord said to Moses, tell Aaron and his sons, this is how you are to bless who? The Israelites, corporately. And there were over 2 million of those Israelites. So God's blessing is a corporate blessing. I thank God for his blessing on Cooper City Church of God. God has blessed us abundantly. But notice, not only is his blessing corporate, he said, say to them, the Lord bless you, and the Lord keep you, and the Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face toward you and give you peace. So out of those 2 million plus people, God would still focus on the individual. And out of over more than 7 billion people on the face of this earth, can I tell you, God can pick you out of any crowd. Hallelujah. That God is concerned not just about the masses, but God is concerned about each and every individual. And as I said, if you're a follower of Christ, you have been blessed. Paul said it like this, praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has, everybody say has, not will, but has, that God has blessed us in heavenly realms with every spiritual blessing in Christ Jesus. If you are in Christ today, you're blessed. You've been saved. You've been healed. You've been delivered. You've been given the gift of eternal life. Paul said it like this in Galatians 3:14. He said he redeemed us in order that the blessing given to Abraham might come upon us Gentiles through Christ Jesus, so that by faith we might receive the promise of the Spirit. Amen. Can I tell you that through Christ Jesus, all of these things we're going to read about here in Numbers chapter 6, all of these things become yours in Christ Jesus. Somebody thank God that he's a blesser today. He's a blesser. So he said, the Lord bless you. The second thing that he says is, the Lord keep you. This is talking about the protection of God. The Lord bless is about the provision of God. This is about the protection of God, that he guards over his kids, that he protects us. It's a picture of a shepherd. You remember when Jesus was born, the night that Jesus was born, the Bible tells us that there were shepherds out in the field keeping watch over their flock by night. That means that they were guarding that flock. They were watching out for the flock. They were protecting the flock. And aren't you thankful today that we have a God who keeps us, who guards, who protects, who watches over us? And see, this is something that you need to be praying, that we need to be praying over our children and over our grandchildren before they ever walk out of the house. As they get ready to start, and listen, this would have been very significant to the nation of Israel, because they're about to leave Mount Sinai and they're about to go into a dangerous wilderness where they're going to have enemies, where they're going to fight battles, where there's going to be dissension and division, where there's going to be hunger and there's going to be thirst. And God says to Aaron, before they leave for this dangerous journey, you've got to speak this blessing over them. Now understand, all Aaron did was speak the blessing. God is the one who did the blessing. Amen. And so when he spoke over them, the Lord keep you, that would have been very comforting to these Israelites to know that God was watching over them and that God was guarding them and that God would be protecting them. And listen, our kids, they're about to go into a wilderness. Many of our public school systems are wilderness. I thank God for them, listen, and I thank God for the wonderful administrators and teachers, but I think that we all know the kind of culture that is present in this world today. And so when our kids leave every day, not just today are we going to pray this over them, but every day before they walk out of the house, the Lord keep you, the Lord guard you, the Lord protect you, the Lord watch over you. Psalm said it like this in Psalm 121, the Lord is your keeper. Hallelujah. The Lord is your shade on your right hand. And out there in the middle of the wilderness where there was no shade from the sun, this would be important for them because God would give them a cloud by day that would keep the sun off of them. And he said that the sun will not strike you by day, nor the moon by night. The Lord will keep you from all evil. He will keep your life. The Lord, do you see how many times that word is here? The Lord will keep your going out and your coming in from this time forth and forevermore. Aren't you thankful that he keeps us? Listen, not only does he keep me in, and not only does he keep me through, but he keeps me from. If you only knew what God has kept you from, yeah, it may have been bad, but it could have been worse. Come on, somebody. It may have been difficult, but it could have been more difficult. You see, if it had not been for the hand of God keeping me, I could have been the one in that accident. If it had not been the hand of God keeping me, I could have been the victim of that crime. How many of us need to understand this morning that there's so much that God has kept us from? Hallelujah. If he had not kept us, many of us wouldn't even be here today. Thank God for his keeping power. I'm alive today because he keeps me. He guards me. He protects me. He watches over me. Hallelujah. The Lord bless you. The Lord keep you. Not like this next one. And the Lord make his face shine on you. This is speaking about the approval of God. Now listen, I know what it's like to have God glare at me. Because there's been some times that I've gone to God in prayer, and maybe there were some things in my heart that God did not approve of. And man, I could just feel his glare of conviction in my life. But this is not about God glaring at you. This is about God glowing towards you. The Lord make his face shine on you. It's the picture of the little kid whose dad or mom has been at work all day long. And they come home, and that kid hasn't seen his parents all day long. And when they come through the door, man, their face just lights up. It's a picture of every grandparent. Woo! In this room here this morning. I told my kids a few weeks ago, I told them, I said, y'all just parents. We grandparents. And they asked me, what do you want to be called? What do you want the grandchildren to call you? Do you want them to call you Peepaw or Pawpaw? I said, no, I want them to call me grandfather. Grandfather. You see, son, you're a father, but I'm a grandfather. Because every time I see those grandbabies coming at me, man, my face lights up. I pick them up in my arms, and they look at me and say, Grandpa, can we go to Walmart? You better believe we can go to Walmart. Whatever you want. Whatever you want. You see, that's what it means to have his face shine on you. He gets happy when he sees you coming, approaching his presence. He's full of joy. He takes delight in you. Let me ask you something this morning. Whose approval are you living for? Whose approval are you working for? Whose face is it that you want to shine on you? Can I speak to every young man and every young woman about to go to school today? You need to make this decision today. Whose approval are you trying to get? Are you trying to get the approval of your peers? Now, I know that we live in a culture that says they're tolerant. Yeah, till you start talking about Jesus. And when you start talking about Jesus, and when you start talking about John 14 and 6, where Jesus said, I'm the way, the truth, and the life, and no one can come to the Father except through me, that there's not many ways to God, there's one way to God, and that's through Jesus Christ. When you begin to declare that message, you will find out how intolerant our culture really is. But listen to me, young men and women, as you get ready to go back to school, don't you shrink back, don't you be ashamed. You stand boldly and you declare Jesus is your Lord, Jesus is your Savior, He's the way, He's the truth, He's the life. Your peers' face may not shine on you, but God's face will shine on you. You may not get their approval, but you'll get the approval of God. Somebody say amen to that this morning. Amen. The Lord bless you. The Lord keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you. And then notice the next thing. The Lord be gracious to you. Now think about who's declaring this blessing. We're talking about Aaron. You say, well, what's the big deal, Pastor? Well, it's just a little earlier that Aaron was the one who led the Israelites to take off all of their gold and throw it in the fire, and they melted the gold down, and then Aaron formed a graven image of a calf, an idol, and they began to declare to that golden calf, this is the God that brought us out of Egypt. That's the guy pronouncing the blessing. The Lord be gracious to you. Because you see, I believe that if we had Aaron here in a testimony service today, that Aaron would say, I'm exhibit A when it comes to this. Because I should have been a grease spot. I should have died. I deserved death because of what I did. But God was gracious to me. And God let me live. Let me tell you what grace is. Grace is the unmerited favor. Oh, I like that word, favor. That's why Jamie and I, we prayed, Lord, be gracious. Lord, put favor on Micah. Lord, put favor on Caleb. Lord, put favor on every one of our grandchildren. Lord, put your favor. Be gracious to our daughter-in-laws, Lord. Because, God, we know that you're able to open doors that nobody else can open. And, God, we know that you're able to connect them with people that only you can connect them to, that they need to be connected to. And God, you're the only one that can get them where it is that we know you want them to go. That's the favor of God. God can open doors for you. God can get you places. God can connect you with people that nobody else can. It's the favor of God. You can't explain it. Well, how did you get there? God brought me here. How did you get through that door? God opened that door. How did you get into that person's office? God got me into that person's office. So we need to be praying the favor of God on our kids. Come on, somebody. The favor of God. God, you can get them much further than I could ever get them. You can teach them so much more than I could ever teach them. Lord, be gracious. Be gracious to them. And then notice what they would pray and what the priest would bless. He would say, the Lord turn his face towards you. Now, when we talk about his face smiling, we talked about the approval of God. But when he turns his face towards you, that means you now have the attention of God. The attention of God. Have you ever noticed when your children were younger, and I don't know, maybe even now, but you ever notice how kids say, hey, Dad, watch this. Hey, Mom, watch this. You may be reading a book. You may be watching TV. You may be hidden behind, well, it used to be hidden behind a newspaper, but your computer screen. You may be busy doing something else. But when your child says, hey, watch this, all of a sudden you turn your head and you give them your attention. And when it says that the Lord turns his face toward you, here's what it means. It means that God is about to do something. That you have God's attention. And somebody here this morning, every young man and every young woman in this room here today, I want you to know that as you get ready to go back to school, God sees you. You have the attention of God. God is watching you. Now, when my boys were growing up, not only did they believe that God was watching them, we convinced them. You just know that the Lord's face is turned toward you because you're his child. He's watching your every move. He's focused on you. And not only were they convinced that God saw, they were convinced that Mama saw as well. Because they were convinced that God told Mama everything. I was talking to Gabe the other day, called her on. I said, I think you had a mama like my boys had, Esther. That our boys, they knew we can't get away with anything. God tells mother everything. And if he doesn't tell mom, he tells dad. And listen, that's because his eye, you have the attention of God. The moment that you as his child, the moment that you call out to God, the moment that you cry out to God, you got his attention. What do you need? What can I do for you? And then notice the last thing that they would pray in this blessing is the Lord give you peace. Shalom. And it's not just the absence of strife. It's not the ceasing of strife. But here's what peace means. It means that you don't have to worry. You don't have to have any anxiety. You don't have to have any stress, because everything God said He will do, He will do it. Now that is peace. Let me show you one of the greatest examples in Scripture that God says something and then the Scripture that declares that it's going to come to pass. That you and I don't need to worry about where the future is going as believers and as followers of Christ. Because John tells us in Revelation 21, I saw a new heaven and a new earth. For the old heaven and the old earth had disappeared, and the sea was also gone. And I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down from God out of heaven like a bride, beautifully dressed for her husband. And he said, I heard a loud shout from the throne saying, look, God's home is now among his people. Hallelujah. This is the greatest blessing right here. He will live with them and they will be his people. God himself will be with them. He will wipe every tear from their eyes, and there will be no more death or sorrow or crying or pain. All these things are gone forever. Peace just simply means that God will eventually restore everything back to its original order. He said he would, and he will. You can trust the Lord this morning that when God says it, and I say to every, again, every young man, every young woman in this room here today, you don't need to start the school year with anxiety. You don't need to start it with stress. You don't need to start it with fear. Because everything that I've just shared with you in this prayer, in this blessing, God's the one who said he would do it, and he will. And this school year, he's going to bless you. He's going to keep you. He's going to make his face shine on you. He's going to be gracious to you. He's going to turn his face toward you. And he's going to give you peace. Would you stand with me all over this room? We're going to sing this blessing. And as we sing this blessing, I want every young man and woman that's about to start school back, I want all of our teachers as well, I want you to get out of your seat, and I want you to come to the front of this building. Our kids from Kid City, they're going to be joining us. And I want you coming forward as we sing this blessing, this prayer over you this morning. Amen.